The 39 Steps by John Buchan. Introduction. It would be easy to call it a case of naïveté on the part of Richard Hannay, but there was much more to the story. He had just returned to London after living in Rhodesia, so he wasn't fully versed in the intrigue going on in England. That wasn't much of a reason for Hannay allowing a man he met to live in his flat. However, that's what he did, even though Franklin Scudder claimed to be a spy with involvement in an anarchist plot to assassinate the Greek premier. Hannay got into a major problem when Scudder was found murdered in the apartment. The victim left behind a codebook containing the phrase, "The 39 Steps," an apparent message indicating the possible planned escape by the conspirators if they were successful in their assassination plot. Although innocent, Hannay was harassed by authorities and had an extremely difficult time before he was finally cleared after explaining his lack of involvement to the Foreign Office. He was extremely convincing and wound up not only being cleared, but commissioned a captain in the English military. The spy group was extremely angry, and Hannay became a man on the run. He fortunately evaded several close calls that could have ended with his death. All this was at a time when England had just entered into the international intrigue days of World War I. You can now hear the thrilling tale of a private citizen who managed to put his country's interests before his personal safety. This is Hannay's story. Chapter 1. The Man Who Died. I returned from the city about 3 o'clock on that May afternoon, pretty well disgusted with life. I had been 3 months in the old country and was fed up with it. If anyone had told me a year ago that I would have been feeling like that, I should have laughed at them, but there was the fact. The weather made me feverish. The talk of the ordinary Englishman made me sick. I couldn't get enough exercise, and the amusements of London seemed as flat as soda water that has been standing in the sun. "Richard Hannay," I kept telling myself, "you have got into the wrong ditch, my friend, and you had better climb out." It made me bite my lips to think of the plans I'd been building up those last years in Bulawayo. I had got my pile, not one of the big ones, but good enough for me, and I had figured out all kinds of ways of enjoying myself. My father had brought me out from Scotland at the age of 6, and I had never been home since, so England was a sort of Arabian Nights to me, and I counted on stopping there for the rest of my days. But from the first I was disappointed with it. In about a week I was tired of seeing sights, and in less than a month I had had enough of restaurants and theaters and race meetings. I had no real pal to go about with, which probably explains things. Plenty of people invited me to their houses, but they didn't seem much interested in me. They would bring me a question or two about South Africa, and then get on to their own affairs. A lot of imperialist ladies asked me to tea, to meet schoolmasters from New Zealand and editors from Vancouver, and that was the dismalest business of all. Here was I, 37 years old, sound in wind and limb, with enough money to have a good time, yawning my head off all day. I had just about settled to clear out and get back to the veld, for I was the best bored man in the United Kingdom. That afternoon I had been worrying my brokers about investments to give my mind something to work on, and on my way home I turned into my club, rather a pothouse, which took in colonial members. I had a long drink and read the evening papers. They were full of the row in the Near East, and there was an article about Karolides, the Greek premier. I rather fancied the chap. From all accounts, he seemed the one big man in the show, and he played a straight game, too, which was more than can be said for most of them. I gathered that they hated him pretty blackly in Berlin and Vienna, but that we were going to stick by him, and one paper said that he was the only barrier between Europe and Armageddon. I remember wondering if I could get a job in those parts. It struck me that Albania was the sort of place that might keep a man from yawning. About 6 o'clock I went home, dressed, dined at the Café Royal, and turned into a music hall. It was a silly show, all capering women and monkey-faced men, and I did not stay long. The night was fine and clear as I walked back to the flat I had hired near Portland Place. The crowd surged past me on the pavements, busy and chattering, and I envied the people for having something to do. These shop girls and clerks and dandies and policemen had some interest in life that kept them going. I gave half a crown to a beggar because I saw him yawn. He was a fellow sufferer. At Oxford Surface, I looked up into the spring sky and I made a vow. I would give the old country another day to fit me into something. If nothing happened, I would take the next boat for the Cape. My flat was the first floor in a new block behind Langham Place. There was a common staircase with a porter and a lift man at the entrance, but there was no restaurant or anything of that sort, and each flat was quite shut off from the others. I hate servants on the premises, so I had a fellow to look after me who came in by the day. He arrived before 8 o'clock every morning and used to depart at 7, for I never dined at home. I was just fitting my key into the door when I noticed a man at my elbow. I had not seen him approach, and the sudden appearance made me start. He was a slim man with a short brown beard and small, gimlety blue eyes. I recognized him as the occupant of a flat on the top floor with whom I had passed the time of day on the stairs. "Can I speak to you?" he said. "May I come in for a minute?" He was steadying his voice with an effort, and his hand was pawing my arm. I got my door open and motioned him in. No sooner was he over the threshold when he made a dash for my back room, where I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.